the basic muscle structures of the torso. The objective, however, is on that other sheet, to try to get the torso to move. And the way it's constructed and the skeleton provides for that movement. You know, you don't get movement unless you have joint systems. The muscles are the harness, I hope you realize from last time's effort, that puts all this into action. It's the action part that translates into what's most useful for you when you're working from the figure. Because the epidemic problem is that the figures look too stiff, or they're uninformed, they don't move, the whole business is designed to move. So, you have a rib cage, pitched at a certain angle, so there's movement already. The axis is as follows. As I stand here, fixing my posture just a bit, rib cage aims up. You can tell what that axis is by looking at the sternum, because the sternum, the breastbone, generally parallels that. Pelvis. You'd expect that would also be pitched, because the deal in the figure is you have masses countering each other as you go along. So what we do is we hitch this together in two places. Spine. Which has four curves. We've talked about that before. Out, in to support the weight. Out, in to support the weight. On the anterior surface of the torso, you complete the contour with a line that rides off the sternum, off the xiphoid process, goes as far as the waist or the end of the rib cage, dives in just a bit. Moves out slightly, that's where navel will be, and then down where rectus abdominis has its origin on the pelvis. So, the pitch then of the pelvis can be read generally by the abdominal wall. So these are two aspects that are right on the surface of the figure. You can see immediately and read what's going on, not internally, but externally. It's right there. So it's really extremely important. The simple plan for the muscles that move the torso are as follows. That you have an erector spinae muscle, which has a zillion points of attachment along on the spine. When all that pulls, it straightens the whole business. And encountering that, the rectus abdominis muscle, which will flex the torso. So if this muscle flexes and bends torso, then erector spinae muscles will extend the torso, or extend the rib cage on the pelvis. Flexing means bending. Extension is straightening. You would say this is bending or flexing, this is extension or straightening. And then there's a side muscle, because here we have this one, and we have this one, very thin up here, and thicker here, and thinner there. And then we have this side muscle for lateral flexion, and also when you twist and pull back, you're pulling on the side muscle pull the torso around. Now what happens with that is interesting. Starting with rib number 5, you have, as rib number 5 comes around, you by the muscle is as follows. That drops down and ties onto iliac crest. Actually, each one of these separate and distinct bundles goes on a more oblique line than that, hence its name, external oblique. But for our purposes, just in identifying back, front, and side, I'm going to do it this way. So each successive rib, in turn, gives a little space. Figure is designed to move. We have to accomplish that somehow. We've got it. It moves. This is the midline. If the midline fails, it's not going to move. If by the placement of a single line you can indicate the movement of the torso, what could be better than that? Use it. Pectoralis major. First rib. First rib is the post of the neck. Trapezius. Ribcage. Ribs aim down, cartilage aims up. Sternum, suprasternal notch. Chromium process. Then what happens? We have pelvis down here. The iliac crest. Pubic bump. Ischial tuberosity, socket for femur called acetabulum, and that attaches to ischial tuberosity. Other side, this is not a pelvis yet. Pelvis means basin. So you've got half to this point. And the other part of the basin. So this comes around, and there's a little plate-like business. Locking this in. Down. So there's the slip to brass sitting on the opposite side. And here's the. This is possible. It's called contrapasto. Not antipasto. Contra means against. Hosto is position, positioning against. Bi does this constantly, all the time. So what happens is on this little side muscle that we just drew in the diagram, what would you expect would happen on this side? The end of the rib cage, what we would call waist. The side muscle that ties to 8 ribs and ties also to the iliac crest. What happens to it? It compresses. This is going down. This is going up. So the side muscle could be quite full at this point. And over here, the side muscle can be quite stretched at this point. Latissimus muscle, this needs to be a little heavier. So you get this fullness, you'll lower that a bit, expressing itself on the flexed side, the bent side, right? And thinning out on this extended side, but still it's going to be there. The reason you're looking for it is your major, it is your major clue that you have found the iliac crest of the pelvis. Because this shape echoes the shape of the iliac crest beneath all of that. Other landmarks, here's waist, navel, nipples of pectoral muscle. This is poor for pectoral muscle on my drawing. The arm is over here. Biceps is where that dot is. Pectoral muscle has to cross biceps because it draws arm across the body. That's better for pectoral muscle. So then the sequence, waist, end of ribcage, the same as waist, navel, external oblique muscle, that gives you the anterior superior iliac spine of the pelvis, a little bump in front, drop down, you have another bump here on the pelvis, that's the site for the origin of the leg. Following that, pubic bone. So you have the sequence, always. Let's do another one, get it to move. Back to you. Center line of the back is obvious. Four curves out to accommodate organs of the pelvis, in and under for weight support, back out for lungs and other organs, back in and under to support the mass of the head. Springing, not static, springing so that it can move, absorb shock as you move. And with this mass, moving relatively independently of this mass. So end of your cage, back in, that's the lumbar section, your sacrum and coccyx. So after a space, you skip a space. If you can see the sacrum, then you know what the pelvis is doing. Maybe in this situation, there's something going on like that. So, as we mentioned before, the way you locate pelvis is to start with the sacrum. Because in this region, it's so difficult to see. So out it comes and opens, goes forward, opens up and splays out. It's my custom to try to get one side, when I'm constructing something that's bilateral, get one side sorted out and then hitch the other to it. That's not always a great idea because it puts puts a lot of emphasis on one side at the total expense of the other side. So as you're doing this, you may want to do one part and then one part. You know, it's like doing one eye and then another eye, or doing them, building them together so that they track properly. Here's the acetabulum. And here's the ischial subarachnoid. On the other side, a piece of the iliac crest. Ischial subarachnoid. What happens in front? Very complex shape. In front here, this will sweep around and join an extension from this side, and this will also sweep up and join it in front. So all this stuff is going in front. So here's this plate in the back. This is advanced. So think of this moving on its axis and this moving on its. If you don't, you see it as a block and it's all over. Your landmarks would be the entire spine, C7, the last cervical vertebrae. If you flex your head, you'll feel where that is, and then above that, a ligament going to your cranium. You may see also T1, thoracic number 1 on the model, those two. You won't see many others. Sometimes if you're here, you may see a few spinous processes with the ligament tying each together, because there's a muscle that does this. It splits apart. So you might be able to see those. We're looking for landmarks. The scapula is essentially one half the length of the rib cage. And it ends in an acromion process, which is a major landmark in the figure, so you find both. You relate both. So you do that in perhaps a sweeping gesture that relates one side to the other. This spine is on a little strut that keeps it out there. Here's the back of the socket for the arm, and here's the inferior angle. Times two, so you flip this over. Might make sense to do this. And that, we're constructing this bilaterally. Chromium process. This you may be able to see, but probably not too much. You may see a piece of this side muscle. If you can find that at all, it's great, because then you know you're on iliac crest. This should be a landmark. This is a major one. This is a major one. And all of this you should be able to see. This you won't. This hopefully you won't. As that is deep and invested with all sorts of muscles that act on the trochanter and the femur. And this, of course, the major landmark you can find. Okay, let's do another one. Muscles that put this all into action we've discussed. That's on that other handout. I just wanted to illustrate some options. Instead of doing that each time, I just do this, sort of a shortcut. That's what that is. They call it pit of the neck, or supra-sternal notch. Supra coming from above. So let's see what this torso is doing. As soon as I put the center line on, You'll know what the torso is doing.